I'm looking at students, and you're looking at me, and I'm a student too, and there's my teacher, so it's a kind of a funny situation. I find myself in here talking to students and to my professor at the same time. Also, fabulous to see so many eminent and gold medalist architects in this room. It's somewhat terrifying, I might say. When Nina asked me to come and do a Year 5 chat, I thought, oh yeah, that'll be easy. And then, but I thought this would be a really good way of kind of exploring this idea of how, I guess, architecture is permeated by cultural thinking. And Nina's given you the kind of title of this talk. And I thought we could use a series of TZG buildings that I've been responsible for to kind of explore this idea. I'd like to say, first up though, a little bit like a confession, but I'm firstly a practicing architect. And for me, the magic of architecture is in the materiality and the experience from which we get from buildings or the spaces that we make. So how do we break down this idea of culture in architecture? It's quite a daunting topic, and I think we can break it down into a series of ways. I'd like to think of this idea of a cultural continuum, so that we can think about we can think of this in a way that both historic and contemporary cultures are interconnected. That contemporary culture effectively rests on top of historic culture, and we can think about contemporary culture, many of the brightest light of the moment. And there's this idea, I guess it's sort of a notion of the compilation of history, that history is all around us, and history is in fact in our present world. We can also start to think about it at a physical level, of a greater system of how everything is physically interconnected. And I have to say that I don't think of buildings as objects in their own right, but part of an urban environment, a landscape, a social network, or in fact a place in time. And that you can start to think of the city as an evolving organism, sort of thriving and dying, receding and regenerating. I'm really interested in urban patterns as kind of systems of order and disorder, and the pattern is the system that orders the body, and it's a holistic strategy that connects the building form to the surface and reconciles individual and collective, the individual and the collective. I find it intriguing and a never-ending kind of source of architecture, the inevitable discord of the city with its energetic disrhythms and ad hoc collections. And I like to think of buildings as miniature cities. So just to put this kind of the projects I'm going to show you, I'd like to put the thinking of architecture into some sort of context. And something that's evolved with working with Fuan, and seeing architecture very much as, I guess, a series of different stages, if you like, that we all have memory. And at the beginning of any project, there's this idea of a period of reflection, that we bring our memory to any project. We all have one, and it is always there. We may not be able to kind of understand what's going on with it, and there may be subconscious values, but it's always kind of there. When we have a project, there's this kind of period of looking, or what I call a period of searching. We're actually looking for something for our project. And a kind of really simple analogy of that is going to the supermarket. If you go to the frozen food section, you'll get frozen peas. If you go to the fresh vegetable section, you'll get a nice fresh banana. When you go to the checkout, that will determine what is in your trolley. We could, of course, cut across that modern Woolworths invention, the interconnecting aisle, and we could put a whole range of different things in our trolley. The idea of sketching, which I call the moment of invention, where there's this kind of crystallization of this vagueness in your mind that starts to coalesce, so the ideas crystallize and come into one. Then this notion of adjusting. So, and I've called that developing through drawing with TZG, so working with groups of architects. And then that sort of almost like a ripple works out with working with consultants to develop technical aspects of our buildings, and then working with builders in the way of the delivery of the building. And then the cycle is kind of completed by this idea of experience, which is a moment of reality when we go, oh my God, what did we do 4 years ago when we came back to look at it? And it's a very interesting idea that I was first exposed to by French author Georges Perec, and he said that each work is the mirror of another. And this is really kind of almost just deconstructing that idea. So that when we work from, we think about architecture as moving from, there's this kind of trajectory from vague, incomplete ideas into built reality, and then it is the repetition. So that's almost like the process of architecture from conceptual vagueness to built reality. And then that makes this process of architecture, but we can think, when we start to think of the repetition of that process, that is what makes the architect. That's why it takes so long to get good at anything. So these, I've got a series of projects which will dip in and out of this matrix. I certainly don't intend to go into every one, but this is the carriage works at Everly, which was Sydney's new contemporary building, performing arts centre, which was completed about 2007. And I'd like to just touch on a couple of these things, so that one of the things that was in my memory when we started this project was this building here, which is called the Mosque of Cordoba. I don't know if anybody knows this, but it's a kind of totally fascinating building. It was a Moorish mosque, and then an act of supreme political and religious domination, a Gothic Christian church was grafted onto the top of it. You might think grafting and cloning are computer terms, actually not. They've been well used architecturally for political gain for some time. But we can kind of see, you can just see these, here's the Moorish architecture here, and the Gothic architecture literally cloned and extended up. And I thought, if you took the politics out of it, that became a very interesting kind of way of looking at the carriage works. One of the things that these are a pair of images. This is about looking. So when we arrived, we found this space. Total vast, empty space, totally romantic, gorgeous light falling from the top, this incredible patina of the industrial history that had been there. But as we started to do our research and delve into images of the carriage works, which was effectively a factory, we found these huge timber hulks in various stages of construction within this space. And so suddenly this idea of this great cavernous, empty, cathedral-esque space sort of suddenly changed to a place of industry that was full of kind of objects. One of the other things that we started to realise was that the way this factory was built, there was no one factory in here. Every few years when they wanted to do something, a new carriage to be built or something, they changed this factory around. So it was merely just a set of coordinates with a spectacular naturally lit roof, and they described the project as tracks which run this way and bays that run that way. So it had its own coordinate system. So I'm just coming here sketching. So the first kind of thought on this building was, started off asking this question, what is the relationship between the inherited building, the inherited artifact, and our new building? It's totally new use, it's a performing arts centre. How does a performing arts centre have its identity within a factory? What's the relationship? And it seemed that this was actually the first sketch, which isn't really a sketch, it's a piece of white paper cut out, stuck into a photograph, and then some shadows being imagined coming through the roof. And it seemed to me that this was a really powerful way of making a relationship between two buildings, two generations, totally different uses, without one totally dominating the other. So the shadow which is cast on the new building comes from the old building. It's kind of ethereal and used. And it brings a level of detail to the surface that we knew we wouldn't be able to afford within our very lean arts budget. This is a kind of one of the early sketches of the foyer, and a couple of things going on here. One, we wanted it to be a huge space because it had been a factory of huge spaces, but the new structures, which are these forms here, were the shape of carriages, very much in the abstract, but we wanted to put something in that space that was reminiscent of the scale of the previous use. And then all these new forms, which is essentially a set of concrete containers for acoustic isolation for all the different uses. And you can see that they're all kind of eroded and chopped away. And that erosion came from this idea of carriages. The carriages were always incomplete forms sitting in that space. And we thought our new buildings could in fact be incomplete forms. This is a kind of very early sketch, and I apologise, I've kind of lost the most important part, but we had to take the roof trusses out of the roof of the carriage roofs. And good heritage protocol says that you put things into storage for another generation to use. And often when we have said, oh, okay, we understand all the stuff is in storage, we'd like to get it out and use it, there's always a lot of embarrassed faces because nobody knows where it is. It's probably decorating somebody's garden. So rather than put these enormous trusses that are 18 metres long into storage, we decided to store them on site, make them vertical, and they became the new symbol for the carriage works as an announcement. The carriage works was intended to be the centrepiece of one of State Rail's master plans. Unfortunately, that didn't kind of happen. So the carriage works was built and all of the surrounding buildings were not built, and this is where the interesting structures here in the Cottage Street, which goes down to the City University. So we can see this kind of plan, which is really nothing more than a distribution of performing arts uses across the floor plan based around the coordinates. And where this came from is that we worked with a very interesting group of people called the Key Research User Group, or KIRG as they refer to themselves. And these were arts-related people who were advising the government agency, which was interesting enough, Treasury, for implementing this project. And they talked about this idea of the anti-theatre. They saw this building very much, the opera house is at one end of the spectrum, the carriage works is at the other end of the spectrum. And they saw this building very much as the bookend from traditional theatre to non-traditional theatre. So they had this idea of anti-theatre, and we translated that into non-hierarchical theatre. Theatres conventionally have a front of house foyer, they have a theatre where the patrons and the performers meet, and then there's a back of house. So what we did here was we took a lot of the front of house functions and put them in the back of house, and then some of the theatre functions we put them in the foyer, so the foyer can in fact be another performance space. It's the fifth performance space. So when we start to look at this kind of long section through the foyer, we can start to see these eroded forms. This is the cafe, it's a large performance space with its carriage. The stairs that take you into the upper levels in this form, and then the erosion again into the corner. Offices up here, box office, and the media performance space. And then the large performance space occupied this space up here and had to go through the roof. And we developed a kind of a, what we call a B story, which is these monitors, taking them and then flipping them to make a roof. This is a vast roof. Each of these bays is 18 metres, so that's 36 metres across this way. To descale this form so that it wouldn't totally overwhelm the 19th century kind of detail of these forms. And then we can start to see, sorry, it's very poor quality, how this kind of works constructionally. This big roof deliberately hangs, so there's no structural load coming down through the old building, so there's a very kind of subtle junction between the two. This is double fiberglass wall as thermal insulation, and then there's a whole ventilation system up in here. There appears to be a tiny slot that has 60 square metres of exhaust, so all of the air is exhausted out in the summer through these slots because it really forms a natural chimney. This is two skins of concrete, and a number of kind of levels in here dealing with the public coming and going and the technical people so that they can have the stage or the audience in any location they want within the space. So this is these drawings are what I would call in the period of adjustments. You can see here that a very crude sketch has found itself into a nice piece of computer modelling where we've actually detailed everything and we know exactly how this works, kind of ramp, which is the level change. And one of the ways we made this happen, it was always known as arts creep, which Treasury loved to use. They put a slightly different nuance on the term, but we put the substation underneath here, so every time they tried to get out of the project, we would innocently say, oh, but it's the substation, and that's where the energy comes from. And at that point, that was fine. The fact that it was a total necessity, it was totally required urban marker to define where this building was, because it's almost two stories below street level. You can't actually see it from the street level, so this became an identifier. So often architects are quite Machiavellian in how we implement our ideas, but it's all for the common good, and that's how we like to argue. The thing that's kind of fascinating about big buildings that sit in context is that they have barriers around them, fences. And I might just come back to here. You can see here there's this little image. Just here, I won't go into the detail, but this is a little girl. She's called Skipping Girl. And this is kind of part of the looking of a project. You know, we can look at the building as an artifact and an object and take things out of the object, but also there's a whole series of social conditions that we might become aware of when we look around a building. So Skipping Girl was painted on the fence by the local community. So there's this vast building that has a fence, you know, hundreds of kilometres long, hundreds of metres long, which is, it's excluding the neighbourhoods. So the neighbourhood's pushing up against this fence. And what somebody had done, had painted about 100 of these Skipping Girls, so that as you drove along in a car or on a bicycle, as you saw out of the corner of your eye, she was skipping. She was at different heights. The rope was spinning around her. Well, this is a kind of really lovely piece of social commentary in a way, and if we could bring that into our building here, we gave Skipping Girl a partner, Skipping Boy. Barbie has Ken, and we thought Skipping Girl would be nice if she had Skipping Boy. And there's this whole miniature scale signage and iconography that goes around the building for things like where the loos are or please be quiet, you know, and the management of the carriage works have used her as a way of making their messages back to the community. And we thought that was a kind of really lovely bridge in that we can think of architecture acting in these kind of really big abstract or ethereal ideas, and then right at the other end of the spectrum with very small literal ideas, and some people may never see past Skipping Girl. Certainly the certification officer didn't see past her. He wasn't buying it at all, because we had her on the ladies and we had Skipping Boy on the gents, and that's brilliant, you know, which is the girls, which is the boys. And he said we needed a New South Wales approved symbol for lavatory. So we've got Skipping Girl now has a friend, and she's very much like an automated robot that sits next to her. So if we just go up to here, this is a kind of photograph of that concrete wall and the shadow coming across it, and the shadow swings across that facade during the day. We reinstated the roof back to its former glory where we could afford to. We couldn't do it everywhere, but we did it very much in the foyer so we could get these shadows casting on the building. Here's the kind of entry sign, and it's finished. It's making a connection to the entry, and the entry was in fact one of the original entries where carriages used to slide through here, but it had been blocked in from our view of that. And then something we were very interested in this building is an idea of non-specific public space. We get briefs that are like thick, and they tell us that there's going to be this number of square metres, and this is going to happen here, and it's going to be connected to this, and then you go there and do that. And we kind of think, because we've adapted a lot of buildings over the years, we've realised that the first thing to be extinguished from a building is, in fact, its function. So that, you know, this is a carriage works, it's no longer a carriage works, it's a performing arts centre. And there's countless buildings that you can kind of see that they're beautiful buildings, they've been retained, but their function has been changed. I mean, you point out this building totally designed within a millimetre of its life. And so this is why there are all these kind of spaces here that we would call a non-specific public space. And what's happening here is that each year the carriage works have a festival where essentially amateur actors can come, or performers can come and try out a piece. And they actually don't need to rent a piece of space because they can just make it happen in one of the corners of the building. And then these spaces were all set up with power and data and the sorts of things that they would need for rehearsal space. And this idea of how one project leads into another, just happening after this project was the Paddington Reservoir Garden. So you can see that in my memory, I've got the carriage works here, because it was very much in our memory at the time. I probably won't spend too much time on the other memory things, other than these are kind of personal little stories, which I won't bore you with, but I would like to make a reference to this building here, which was one of the buildings that we were very aware of when we started this project, which is Carlo Scarpa's Castel Vecchio in Verona. And I had been there as a student, and I was totally mesmerised with this idea that a completely contemporary ribbon had been threaded through a medieval castle. Castel Vecchio is now an art gallery. And there were two readings of this building. There was the reading of Carlo Scarpa's work, which was immediate, it was modern, it spoke of now. And then there was the medieval castle, which had lost its use, it had become an art gallery. And between the two of them, there was this kind of magic reading where you oscillated between different periods. And I think that was something that was very much in the back of our mind through the reservoir. But just to touch on a couple of kind of things when we started this project, and this is very typical of this sort of project, it was just nothing more than a tip. We had, you can hardly see the structure of the building, it just become a kind of a ruin. But needless to say, it was an incredibly evocative ruin, and it was made of fragments. You could get a sense of all these kind of fragments. And then the other thing so kind of wonderful is its location. So this is Oxford Street, Paddington, and it's a very interesting street. And I remember the first building I ever, or one of the earlier buildings I worked on in Sydney back in the early 90s, this old fellow told me that he wasn't an architect by any means. He said he always thought Oxford Street was so important because it split the harbour, the rocky fingers of the harbour, from the soft sandy bay of Botany Bay. And I know, Rick, you talk a lot about that, and so I'm not going to talk too much about that because you do it so articulately. But it's a really interesting idea that this reservoir is cut into the ground, and I think if we could do something with the ground, actually moving into the kind of ground. So this is what it had been. It collapsed. It was a 1950s park. And we were pretty much asked to come back and reinstate this park. And there was probably a whole lot of reasons why we didn't think that was a good idea, but at a kind of city level and an architectural level, we had inherited this incredibly evocative ruin. Sydney is a young city, so it doesn't have many ruins. And we thought just to cap the park would be a kind of a fairly boring thing to do, really. And then here we can start to see again, we're looking, what is the structure we've inherited? So we can't really see it in reality, but it's not much more than a tip. And there's this totally beautiful structure, which is really the kind of zenith of British engineering, which kind of went through the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries. This was built between the 1860s and 1870s. So all of the knowledge of this came from hundreds of years of development. Very beautiful cast iron vaults, little vault plates here, cast beams sitting on hand-cut timber posts on stone plinths, and then the whole thing was covered in a very scientific and heavy clay to hold it all together. And it seemed to us if the you then start to ask this question again, what is the relationship from one generation to another? This project, it seemed to be, it was this really interesting opportunity that because the fragments that we had inherited were really minor, you know, very fragile and very minor, that somehow we could amplify those ideas. And so this almost the sketch for this project lies in this word here, which is called narrative, which is Suzanne Turner's probably not the right word. But it just summarises a sentence, which is something like the concept for the new use is actually lurking within the artifact. So that we're not bringing something new here. We're not being totally differential to what's here. We're not copying what's there. And we're not bringing something totally new. But we are looking at what we've inherited, and we're pulling conceptual ideas out of that. Just before we get into that, and we'll come down this column in a minute. When you are in a situation where you have a brief that says Cap Park from a local government client, and then you have your own architectural ideas, which are different, it's very difficult to try and reconcile those. Often that's done collectively through a competition process where architects are invited to put in their ideas. What is your idea for the site? But when you get a brief, you're sort of expected to accept that brief as the idea. And I think that's often where a lot of the mediocrity of our cities come from, is that the people who are imagining what those sites could be are not us. And so we believe that we should campaign to actually take that position. Competitions are very hard, you spend a lot of money on them, and they have very low success rate. So here we came up with a series, and I'm not going to bore you with the details, but we came up with an idea. We then had five faux ideas of how we could sort of stretch the city council from a cat park, lifting up corners, to ultimately having something that looked like this, which is really, you know, a garden which you can see there's a series of rooms and it's kind of falling in and it's a ruin. So it's not a park, it's a collection of urban rooms. It's very interesting. So that when we started to talk about this with the management people at the City of Sydney, they were justifiably very nervous for a couple of reasons. It wasn't what the brief said they wanted. And secondly, we were proposing public space below street level. And anybody involved in public space and urban design generally has the belief, for good reason, that it's not a good idea because of recalcitrant activity. They said we had one shot, we could present it to the mayor, because they don't really want to deal with it. So we got our meeting with the mayor, no pressure, and we explained this idea, and it's pretty amazing because she got it instantly. She said, do you mean like the hanging gardens of Babylon? And we said yes, and she came up with another set of gardens that nobody knew of, but we agreed wholeheartedly. And it was incredible because the existence of this building is down to political leadership, because the mayor of the city, Sidney Cove-Moore, had the guts to actually say, I think this could be a good idea. And that is incredibly rare in the public domain. So that's how the building came into being. Somebody put up their hand and said, well, there's a problem with public space underground. And we didn't have the answer. She had the answer. She said, that's easy. There's a bloke who locks up Centennial Park at night. He unlocks it in the morning. He can come down and do this one as well. That was the end of it. So it was kind of pretty amazing. So we walked out of this meeting thinking, gosh, we've got this kind of fantasy job that we never thought would really happen. You know, we often propose ideas that we think have got no chance. So this very ethereal notion of the concept for the new use lurks within the artifact. Then how do you take that in this trajectory from a very vague conceptual idea into finite reality? So we break that down into very simple things, like the existing building has three materials. The new building will have three materials. The existing building's made out of cellular units being bricks, so that when we had our concrete, which was our masonry material, we broke that into cellular units, just throwing bricks. When we have our sunscreen, the patterning of the sunscreen is in fact taken from the water jet. So we've, magically kind of pulled the mortar joints out of the brickwork. And it's not so much about the catchy idea, it's about scale. So we know that this will have a scale that matches with that. So this is kind of moving between. And I think one of the other really interesting things with this narrative, and it's where the word narrative came from, it gave us a device to talk to other people. So in the suggesting phase, when we're starting to talk to our collaboration partner, Anton James from JMD, this became sort of part of our reference and conversation. And Anton had this fantastic idea. He said, well, let's look at plant species that were fashionable in the 1860s and 1870s. So we could kind of go. So here we have these kind of punga palms that you don't really see anywhere in Sydney except in the botanic gardens. And I just thought that was because that was the only place they could grow. So Anton and his team did some experience, did some research and found out that they would grow quite nicely here. Now this photo is taken very early on, so they haven't grown up, but now this is just a totally kind of lush punga palm plantation in here. And then when we were talking to the electrical engineers, they suggested this idea that if you put red and blue light together, you get a natural oscillation to evoke water. This space would have originally had water in it. And this not everybody, buys this argument. I was explaining this to somebody once, and they thought, because it was on Oxford Street, it was just a very kind of Mardi Gras idea. The planning is made out of a series of fragments. It's a fragmentary plan. And fragments are really interesting because we start to perceive, why are ruins so interesting? It's because we see fragments, we interpret the fragments as being part of a greater whole, but we have to make up that greater whole. So we're using our imagination to realise that building and the name. But here we start to use these fragments to do a series of things for us. One was that the planning strategy was all about a fragmentary planning strategy. So we had pieces of space, not whole, complete spaces that we would normally do if we were starting from fresh. And we can start to see here, there's a whole kind of set of spaces that are all nicely interconnected through this kind of fragmentary structural system, and we've left fragments of the original building. But it's a whole series of pieces, and when you come here, you have to kind of use your mind to sort of bring this all together. So a little bit of space underneath the canopy, a wall and more space underneath the canopy, but you can see all the way kind of through. And then we can kind of take this into some detail. So this is just a gate, and a gate. Here we go. So we can kind of see this gate. In public space, we end up with a lot of controlling elements, so balustrades, gates, signs, all those things to tell people what to do, what to do, where to go, and more point, where not to go. And so this idea that the security gate is actually made out of the letters are organised in a fragmentary manner, and the frames just kind of cut out through here. It's an angle frame, and that piece there is being rotated 180 degrees, so that this kind of fragmentary device keeps going through the design, and that comes back to this idea the new use is lurking within the artifact. So it's going back to this kind of central idea at a kind of a vision for the site, at a kind of planning or organisational way, and a kind of a detail way. And I won't Dante-esque kind of views up out of the reservoir, and then these roof canopies, which really are a device for shading down here, but also to tell people moving along Oxford Street that there actually is public space down below. So this is working along Oxford Street. And then, of course, this project has led to other projects. This is a hotel which we have under construction at the moment. And then we inherited a 1930s deco hotel. And then here was an administration building, an office building from cobbled together from over a period of about 80 years, starting in the late 1890s. And then the idea was that our new architecture takes a kind of scale and organisation of the windows of this building and the same here, and starts to stitch them together. And this is very much the kind of third building, which is light and glassy, stitches it together. And or even a series of fit-outs. These are airport lounges for Virgin Australia, but you can see this idea of a fragment. These are totally organised around the idea of a fragment, thinking that this could actually be a really boring idea, having a place where people sit down and eat food and have coffee and wait in a kind of frustrated sort of way for the plane. But by bringing in all these fragments as a way of trying to get a visually kind of stimulating space. So I'm going to do two small projects for my next 10 minutes. There's a whole lot of other things, but I just wanted to talk about this one for a moment because I find it kind of fascinating in a way, in how we can oscillate between thinking about history and being contemporary at the same time. So this is a gallery. It's actually inside the carriage works, and it was a commission from the kind of truly formidable Anna Schwartz, who I have to say is one of the most terrifying clients we have ever had. Not because she's a scary person, but because her dedication to architecture is just totally kind of spectacular. Her brief was that a commercial art gallery dwells in a democracy of what she called white light. So she talked about three things that sort of just totally, made my sort of mind go off on every sort of tangent you could imagine. So this idea of the white light of democracy in a commercial gallery. So that was really kind of her sentence of what a gallery was. So we started to think about that, and then up here you can kind of see a little sculpture. That's a Bill Colbert sculpture, but we started to think about democracy not so much in classical antiquity, but in the fluorescent baton, the white light. And then as we started to sort of think about this gallery, the white light became a symbol for the gallery, and then we started to use it as a line, and then the line began to coalesce together to make a plane, which was the top surface of the white shoebox. I mean, clearly our brief for this commercial gallery was white walls. And it was a kind of really interesting device to have it. It's a white surface, it's a plane, but the plane is made up out of a series of white lines. And those white lines, in turn, allow a reading of the historic roof. So we're kind of, it's on one level, you can see here it's more like a plane. When you walk in, you very much feel like it's a plane. When you're in the gallery, it dissolves, and the historic building starts to come through. So it's another way of playing with this relationship. And then this kind of totally amazing concrete floor that when we put the white box on the concrete floor, we started to almost, like an archaeologist's frame, we started to put a whole lot of emphasis on this floor, and we could start to see the kind of, the scars of industry and the way they chopped a bit out and moved around, and it's all there for everybody to kind of see. And I love this photo because it's to me it's really interesting because it's an exhibition by the late Robert Klippel, and he went through this phase of taking castings of so these are wooden molds that were actually made in the carriage works, so they would make a wooden mold to make a casting to make a piece of carriage. And so what he's done here is he's taken an expedient tall, if you like, a wooden object, a piece of wood that was used for a casting. He's then cast that in itself, and in doing so, he's kind of he's increasing the importance of this object. He's taking something from what is almost a craft expedient object and turning it into a cultural artifact. So he's taken something from this building, he's taken it away. He's in some ways made it more important. He's brought it back, only to be taken away at the end of the show, and maybe find a way to come back again. And I thought this is a kind of really lovely metaphor for how we, I think, in the office think about architecture is that it's not just one thing, it's continually kind of evolving. And just in my last 5 minutes, I'm just going to shoot over a series of projects. I've run out of time. I did want to put in a series of what I'd call relatively ordinary projects, which I'll just screen through them really slowly. But what I find interesting about them is that they're kind of the grist of the city. And as we, after 5 minutes, go to new cities and we go to an important building or a new building, it's actually the passage of going to that building where you actually get a sense of the city and what's interesting about the city. So I'm just going to come back to here. So this is a very small little building in New Zealand. It's for LVMH at Cloudy Bay, and Cloudy Bay is a vineyard. It's actually on a piece of land called Cloudy Bay, but it's known as Marlborough. So when you see a wine label from Marlborough, this is the region from which it comes to. So for me, having grown up in New Zealand, it brought back a whole lot of things about New Zealand. This idea of the landscape, and I might just flip into some of these. That this is a painting called 6 Days in Nelson, and I can see down here, Canterbury. Nelson is just on the other side of the hills from where this building is. And for me, this kind of encapsulated some of my memories of New Zealand, this idea of this foreboding landscape where the sky and the land are so tightly interwoven, there's actually no real room for human habitation. And that's not true, of course. That's my kind of reading of it. And I think that's really fascinating when we come and look at a site, that we can always... There's a kind of a faux factual basis when we look at a site. We say the site doesn't stand, we see this and all that sort of thing. You could ask 10 architects and they would all give you a different reading of that site. But nevertheless, it's very important that we have that response, but at the same time acknowledging that it's very much our personal view, which is based on our memory. I also have this kind of memory of really interesting modernist architecture, which was happening when I was a kid. But I sort of found this when I was in my early 20s. Yes, this is called Christchurch College at Canterbury University in Christchurch. And it's a really beautiful modernist building designed by a man called Sir Miles Warren, or a firm called Warren and Marnie. And I love it because it's kind of petite brutalism. It's kind of colonial, and it's Christchurch is a colonial town. Things were small, and people were very resourceful because resources were limited. So they took the architecture of the Smithsons from England in the 60s, or he did, and he brought it back to New Zealand, but he did it on a small scale that actually made it so much more poetic than the originators of this movement. And then there was another architect at the time called Peter Bevan, and he designed this building, which had a narrative, it had a whole mythology about it, which I won't go into. But he was a kind of very romantic kind of architect. So I had these sort of things in the back of my mind when I was confronted by this building. And this is where it sits. It isn't actually that big. This is a kind of pictogram. But there are these hills here called the Richmond Ranges. This is the bay. This is actually called Cloudy Bay because the clouds form here in the morning and roll in here. And then this is their iconic wine label. And the brief for us was to make a connection between the representation of the wine and the experience of the place. Because what these guys do is, at Cloudy Bay, they do the best junket on earth. They bring French sommeliers out from Europe. For a week, they put them in the shack, and then they put them in a helicopter each day and take them off to a different part of New Zealand. And I just put this in because this is my best friend in the world. This sommelier who was staying here for a week, and he'd been off somewhere exotic, and at the end of the day, he came back and dragged the sofa outside. He got a bottle of their finest something, fell asleep with a cigarette and this was burnt down. So, Christopher Wren was the benefactor of London, and in some very small way, we became the benefactor of this French sommelier who basically created our job because they needed another shack. And they called it shack, and there was this whole kind of mythology around it. You know, you can see it was very much a shack. But in the time between there and there, Cloudy Bay had been bought and sold by one French company, and it's now owned by another French company. So LVMH, you know, the world's ultimate luxury brand, now owns this building. So then how do we reconcile this idea of, you know, the super glamorous global luxury, the kind of global economy, with the regional in New Zealand? And in some way, you know, we can start to work through these images. It becomes quite interesting. For me, the regionalness comes through the work of these two architects, which you can start to see in these shapes. This idea of the place all came about by creating a building that, oh, well, we might just flick through these, it's just kind of easier. It was deliberately long and skinny. It's essentially a veranda, and that space there looks straight out at the vineyards and the Richmond ranges, and we can kind of see here this section. And here, it's like a, well, it's not a panopticon, but it's opening out like a trumpet to the view. So that's the Richmond ranges and vineyards. So this is incredibly, when you're in this space, you are always being pushed into the landscape because it's all about making a relationship between that label and the place. And so nobody would stay here for more than a week. I think if it was your own house, you'd probably be driven nuts because you'd feel there's no true interior. But, and then I guess the other thing I just want to say here, this is probably something to do with my relationship to this landscape, the idea that I couldn't bear the idea that this building would be totally subservient to this incredibly aggressive landscape that New Zealand has. In New Zealand, you can see the landscape changing. It's that kind of volatile. And so this is kind of the front door standing up to the landscape, but totally concealing the views that as you come through the front door. Then that view has started to be exposed. This is surrounded by an enclosure of trees. And then if we start to look at that slightly more detailed plan that we have in here, we can kind of see how that kind of works it out. It's very long. It's about 26 metres along that side there. This is the front door. And then stairs up to a series of bedrooms that sit along here upstairs. The wine cellar deliberately on axis, so you sit here, the table's pushed off to the side, and you can sit here. Everything's non-flammable in this space, of course. And so then you look out through there. And then a kind of very oversized kitchen with a back door because it's for commercial kind of catering for events and parties. And then we had a partner architect on this job, Paul Roth, who had worked at TZG for a number of years. And Paul was a local architect. We had these kind of very interesting discussions where Paul was very keen to kind of break the building down into a series of expressed elements. And I think we were thinking, well, I was thinking slightly more of this kind of finite object. And then we sort of, I'll just give you a sense of what it looks like. That's the building that was built in this incredible, luscious kind of landscape. Here we are pushing out into the view. And then, so you can see a little bit of the Richmond Ranges here. They do run all the way across here. It's just, it's hard for the photographer blurring up. You can see it's very narrow through here, and you can continually push into that landscape. And then, over here, we start to see the kind of reconciling between this sort of French or urban, French or European kind of sophistication and the New Zealand humbleness. So we pick, you know, the kind of good old standard New Zealand plywood, which they kind of use everywhere, but we detailed it in an incredibly sophisticated way. And I think that was ultimately how Paul and I resolved our differences over the detailing system of the building. We went back into this kind of central idea and said, well, what are we trying to do here? And we decided that by detailing the building in an incredibly kind of clean and sophisticated way, but using very humble materials, wood on the outside, whether on the inside predominantly wearing steel on the outside, that we could, I guess we kind of use the conceptual idea to reconcile our architectural differences. And I think I'll conclude here. This is the front door, kind of weathering steel. And I made another friend on this job who was the Pinot winemaker, and they have fantastic parties at this place. And he got very drunk at the end of the party, and he told me that I had evaginated the front door of his building. I didn't quite know what he meant, but I think what he meant was to fold in on oneself, and I will fold into myself. And then, yeah, so, thank you very much for having me.